Hello friends, I'm Paul Shin in Hickory Corners, Michigan. Ken Fishon is the curator, I guess, of the Gilmore campus, correct? Is that the right name?
No, I'm not curator. I'm actually director of commercial operations,
but I train
all of our docents and volunteers and manage car shows and events with our team. And
head honcho.
Yeah, well, sort of, kind of, yeah.
But we're in front of the Classic Car Club of America Museum building. We're going to take a look through here. Ken is going to help us figure out what we're going to be looking at. But we got to start off with the history of this campus. First of all, Mr. Gilmore, it was basically the same story that most of us have, you know, where you retire, the wife wants you to get out and do something. She bought him a classic car. It was a Pierce Arrow.
Yeah, it sits right in that building.
In that building behind the camera. And to make a long story short, he and some buddies got together, restored it. It led to a car obsession, which eventually led to this incredible campus. I can't even call this a museum. This is seven partner museums together in one area. We're going to talk about that in a little bit, but first we're going to go take a look in here and see some incredible classic cars.
All right, sounds good. Let's go.
Let's do it.
So anyway, as I was starting to say that, you know, technically a classic car is 25 years or older. Well, a full classic had to have been built between 1915 and 1948. It had to be incredibly innovative in terms of design, engineering, and less than 2% of total production. So many of the cars you're gonna see in here are one of four, one of one, one of maybe 10 or 11. You know, they don't even know on some of these. So this building underwent a massive multi-million dollar renovation and expansion a year before last, and they added over 11,000 square feet of space, plus they've transformed the main lobby when we go in to the Astor Hotel in 1918, really the start of the automotive salons.
Oh, I can't wait to see it.
This is intended to really talk about the 1929 and really this automotive salons. Now, what happened, if you wanted to buy a car in the early 1900s and it was a foreign-made car, you could not buy it in the United States. You had to travel to that country, purchase it there,
and
have
it
shipped back. So not real easy for foreign automakers to be able to sell their cars here.
Sure.
So they came up with an idea. They said, we're going to take the ballroom of the ritziest hotel in New York, and we're going to transform it into a automotive showroom for all of our cars. And so the Astor Hotel was the first property that they used. And this lobby and this gallery is made to look exactly like the Astor Hotel in 1918. And you'll see all the black and white photos.
It's just incredible. As soon as you walk in, it's just striking.
Yes. And these are, it's a barn, but these are real antique crystal chandeliers. And the pillars here are made to kind of combine the feel of the hotel, but still keep the feel of the Barrett Barn, which is, this was our first partner museum built on the property.
This is incredible. We haven't even gotten into it yet.
Yeah.
It's just breathtaking.
Yeah. This car has a really fascinating story. This is a 1924 Packard 143.
This is just breathtaking. Look at this.
But look at what it looked like. It was
torn
apart
so
and
cool.
Turned into a tow truck. And Don Hansen found this car and took him over 30 years restoring it. Look at the needle point in the back seat there, the iris and the flowers.
That's incredible.
Just an incredible car.
So in the Model A world, we'd call this a town car.
Yes, this is called a town car too.
It is. Oh.
It is. It's a town car.
Yeah. But see, this is kind of cool because the driver gets a little bit of
protection. Right, right. And the whole idea, we always explain to people that, you know, the first cars were, you know, you were transitioning from a carriage pulled by a horse to a horseless carriage. So the first cars, you know, had the steering wheels on the right side because that's how you reined.
That's the curb side.
Reined to the
horse.
The brake
was over there.
And then you also, the town car mimicked a carriage because the driver of the carriage always sat out in the open while the guests were in the enclosed coach.
Yeah, like the Wells Fargo.
And that's where we get the coach builder thing too. Mm-hmm. So as we get into the main gallery here, it's split down two sides. One side is focusing on automakers, the other on coach builders. So of course the coach builders you know, the automakers built the engine, the drivetrain, the chassis, and then the coach builders built the body and the interior too. So yeah, this is just a stunning example of a beautiful town car.
It is. Yeah,
this is a, you know, this has got a great story too. This is a 1930 Stutz. It was built in Indianapolis, and it was a teenager's first car.
I see that.
And he brought it home, and his father was like, "Oh my gosh, what did you buy?"
Right.
"You're a darn fool," he said. And this is a very rare supercharged 1930 Whoa. Stutz convertible coupe. It has custom coachwork by Durham. And we say, it doesn't seem too foolish now, does it?
Nope, not at all. Oh, can you just imagine your first car and it being a supercharged 140 horsepower, incredible machine?
Well, my first car was a 59 Cadillac convertible. And to me, that was a pretty awesome car to have as a first car, for sure.
Well, my first was a 74 Ford pickup. And it wasn't very old at the time.
Oh,
so.
that's cool, yeah. But it was. There's two things in life I don't ever want to be without: Paul, a pickup truck, and a dog.
Yeah, right? Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, we also have a large collection of mascots and hood ornaments. They were in the Train Depot building, which is being renovated and turned into bathrooms. So we'll be putting that out on display in another area, probably in the carriage house. But that is out. But these are all, and many of these were just fun ones, and Marvin Tamaroff collected all of these. And when he was talking to his kids and saying, "Well, what am I, you know, when I pass away, I want you to have this." Well, the kids didn't have any interest in it whatsoever. Ooh. So that's why he made arrangements to donate it to the Classic Car Club of America Museum.
Marvin Tamaroff, well done.
Yeah, yes. Unbelievable. So people have a great time, as you can see.
How many hood ornaments are here?
Oh, we have the largest collection, along with ours, and one of the largest collections in the world. Yeah, there's...
Any idea how many?
I think in here there's, and these are not all out on display, there's about 1,200.
Oh,
and we have another about 1,000. Yeah.
Wow. I can't believe it. This is awesome. I could spend all day in here.
Yeah.
Wow, your building needs to have some cots or something in here.
Oh, well, we've got upstairs. I have to show you upstairs because it's all done like a living room lounge.
Perfect.
It's kind of like where you would go and entertain people. You can sit down. And
all right, I'll bring my jammies and
there you go. Yeah,
good to go.
So Raymond Dietrich was known as the Michelangelo of design, and he designed for so many different car companies and really created some incredible cars and designs. You know, he worked with Duesenberg. He did just a tremendous amount. He lived here in Kalamazoo, and this room was set up to mimic his studio.
This is like what they did for Charles Schultz, kind of. For,
yeah, yeah.
But I've heard the name Dietrich so many times. So what all did he work on besides, I see, you know,
well, behind you, he designed the Gibson Firebird guitar.
Wow.
In addition to designing many, many different cars as well. So he was really quite a man.
Wow. And basically, here's his office.
Yes.
Wow. What a great tribute to a great man.
Welcome to the Grand Gallery. And if you would like to come, Paul, and stand in the circle, the lights will come down.
Would I ever.
We'll get to talk about car design.
The lights have dimmed.
A car is essentially composed of boxes. The engine compartment, usually in front, is a box.
She said it was composed of boxes. I'm assuming all the ones the parts come in.
Yeah, so, no. So we have some, like, just I'll point out some of the features of some of the cars. This one in particular, the 37 Cord 812. This was
stunning,
innovative in terms of design and engineering. It was the
front-wheel drive.
First car with front-wheel drive, first car with hidden headlights. And this was also known as a coffin front. But for me, this is supercharged. I like it better when they're not supercharged, just as personal design, because these extend all the way back to the doors of the driver and the passenger on both sides. And so from that design element, I mean, performance-wise, obviously you want it supercharged.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah. And this Yale Cord built his Auburns and Cords in Auburn, Indiana.
Mm-hmm. Just and a hop, skip, and a jump here.
Yeah, yes, yep. So,
wow.
This is another beautiful.
And then we just turn to the right, and here's a 31 Cadillac.
Cadillac 370 V12. And these were known as the country club cars.
Oh, yeah?
Because
you had
a rumble seat, and this is the only storage you had, and guess what it's for, Paul?
Golf clubs.
Golf clubs, yes. Right. Golf clubs go right in there, because this would really, you wouldn't take this car to shopping, because there's really no place to put anything. You wouldn't take it on a trip, because you don't have any place for luggage. Whoops, sorry. Even though it did have a trunk stand in the back, if you wanted to put a trunk on it. But yeah, it's just an absolutely beautiful, beautiful car. 135 horsepower. And wow. They did build just a little over about 5,700 of these.
That's still fairly rare.
Yeah.
But V12, I'm assuming this thing is smooth as silk.
And it uses a lot of gas.
Of course. That's right. She's thirsty.
Yeah, she's a thirsty girl. Now, behind you, this is a spectacular three-colored red Pierce Arrow.
This is stunning.
It's a 1932 Pierce Arrow Model 54. The one really, Pierce Arrow and Packard and Peerless were known as the three P's of luxury during this era. And in the White House, it was usually always a Packard or a Pierce Arrow. So these were very popular luxury cars. This particular car had a little over 1,100 produced. But one of the interesting style design things, the Pierce Arrow lights were on the top
fenders.
Of the fenders. But the problem was people were used to seeing lights right along the radiator.
So they complained, didn't they?
Well, no. They thought it was two motorcycles coming down.
Two motorcycles.
Road. And so then as cars got faster, they added the lights on the inside too, because there weren't street lights like we have today. And the faster a car would go, the more danger you'd be in. But
sure.
I think the most spectacular thing on this is the Pierce Arrow Archer. So as you look down through the Grand Gallery here, on the left focuses on automakers and the right on coach builders.
Wow.
Now, this beautiful
Packard. I don't know where to look.
Yeah. Now, this Packard right here used to be parked over here. This is another one. This is designed, this 1940-180. Darren did the coach work. And this is one of the first cars. You're not going to like it, because look what he did with the running board. He deleted the running board.
Running board delete.
But it is just a spectacular car. And we don't know how many he made. It's either 11 or 12.
I presume this is number two, judging by the plate.
Yeah. Number two. Now, this car used to be parked right over here. And we took it out for the first weekend in June for the touring, and guess who got to drive it out of here?
Got to or had to?
Quite a challenge.
I bet.
It was fun.
I bet.
It was fun, though. Yeah.
You know, we have saying Model Airs. There's like the 160C, and there's other four-door. We call it the blind back because it doesn't have the quarter windows.
Yeah.
This is the triple blind back.
Oh, it is. Yeah, they did not have, and if you see, we'll get to the Delahaye in a minute. The Delahaye, when the top's up, the window's this big.
Oof.
And there's no bumpers.
Oh, nerve-wracking. I can imagine how nervous one must be.
Now, would you expect to see Buicks in here?
No, not really,
well,
but
check these two out.
You know
out.
What, the everyman's car? Yeah.
Yeah, these were both built in the UK, and they're both completely custom, one of one. This is the only one of each of these cars.
Well, that's a very unusual front end.
Yeah.
I've never seen anything like that.
The Maltese?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've never seen anything like that. It is a Buick.
Yep.
It's just,
like I said, a one of one.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Well, and we're talking about coach builders now. So again, sky's the limit.
Right.
Right.
You can have
your imagination.
You can really customize it. And yeah. So this is our 39 Delahaye. We have, it is just, to me, a stunning car. It came in this, these were colors very popular for women's fashion in the 1930s. And I've had the pleasure of riding in this, and also, but this is the one where I was telling you, the back window, when the top is up, is this
big. It's only
big.
That big.
And look at back here. Look at the design of this car, but no bumpers.
Oh, I know. This is just sexiness on wheels,
yeah,
right,
isn't
here.
It? Yeah, it's art in motion. Just a beautiful, beautiful car. And this one does get out and gets driven around the campus.
Wow.
And it's been taken to several shows as well.
But it's no wonder you see Delahaye at Pebble Beach.
Yes.
All the time.
Yes.
It's no wonder. I get it. Now, looking at one in person, I get it.
Yep. And this is one of four. Yeah, no Chevys in here.
Nobody can mistake a Rolls-Royce. Once you've seen the grill,
right,
you know what you're looking
well,
for.
Well, yes, somebody can. Romer.
Romer? Tell
Romer
me about
was
that.
Romer built one of the 17 automakers in Kalamazoo, and they built what was billed the American Rolls-Royce. And the museum owns three Romers, and right now they're all in our climate-controlled storage building. Oh, yeah. They're not. We don't have any out on display. But they did look very much like, the grille was very similar to Rolls-Royce.
But look at the headlights, the size of the headlights.
Yes.
I mean, spotlights.
Well, yeah, yep. And there are only 492 of these built, cost a whopping $5,000 in 1939.
Yeah, but that was a lot of money.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still a lot of money now, but I mean, it's a lot of money as we walk past two gorgeous Lincolns.
Yes.
Into what is just breathtaking. I don't even know what to say.
This is a 1937 Delage, and this car was in the movie An American in Paris. But just an absolutely, I mean, look at those Landau bars, and look at the length of the hood.
That's like 9 feet.
Yeah, we have two of these. We have another one that is just spectacular. That's in our in the exhibit I'm going to take you to next. Yeah,
this
it's
is
a 120 D8 120 Cabriolet touring car. But just look at the, just like you said, art on wheels. I mean, it's just a spectacular car.
This is sexiness on wheels.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, sexiness on wheels. Now, see what you think. How sexy do you think the tap?
This looks a lot like the Phantom Corsair that we saw.
Yeah,
and it also kind of looks like an Airflow, a Chrysler, but
it does
clearly,
or a Scarab,
yes,
yeah,
but clearly there's something special going on here.
The Nazi killer,
this,
yes,
because
built in Czechoslovakia, and it had a 8 V8 air-cooled engine in the rear.
Okay,
and the fin was supposed to be part of design, but also to help stabilize it, because what would happen when Germans were driving this on the Autobahn, and they get up to 90, 100 miles an hour, there's no weight for the engine
in the front end.
And so they'd wreck and crash, and so they became nicknamed the Nazi
killer. Nazi killer? Oh,
and there's Jay Leno showing you his Tatra. And they're one of the oldest European auto manufacturers. They still build trucks, Tatra trucks in Czechoslovakia, but no more passenger cars.
This is one of the prettiest Phaetons I've ever seen.
It's a 1922 Isotta Francese Type 8, and this was originally built for Queen Marie of Romania. 90 horsepower, and it's a pretty light car. It was easy to push this in and out of here.
Really?
Yeah. And when you look at it, you wouldn't think that, but
no.
I mean, and look at the beautiful, look at the fenders.
Gorgeous.
The design of the fenders.
But the two-tone paint with the chrome that separates
Yeah, just stunning.
Mind blown.
So we call this an automobile fit for a queen.
I see why.
Yeah.
I know we skipped the Lincolns, which seems wrong, but
yeah.
Then you come over here.
These
now
are
I understand.
The K cars. So you've got the KB over here, which was the top of the line in 33, and this was 36, and it's just an absolutely gorgeous car. They did only about, let's see, what was it, 1,550 of these.
Okay.
It sold for $4,200.
Wow.
In 36.
Nearly Rolls Royce money.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep, just 800 shy of a Rolls Royce.
Wow.
3 years later, yeah.
But Lincoln was not the everyman's car. I get it.
No, no. But this car really has been compared many times to the Marmon 16 or the Duesenberg, because it was such an incredibly beautiful car. And, you know, of this, they only built a little over 500.
And then we just walk over here, and here's two more breathtaking cars.
Yeah, this is a 29 all original unrestored Cord.
Oh, you know,
L29 town car.
I love original unrestored cars so much. Wow.
And when you talk about that flat windshield,
yes,
it doesn't get any flatter than that.
No. Clearly, this is as flat as it gets.
Yeah.
But this car is such a treasure.
Yeah, we have
American-made
treasure. Limousines in here that are all original. We skipped one of them coming in here, but I can show you that too.
I mean, I'll look at an original car any day.
We're going to talk more about him and the Duesenberg brothers and their partnership when we get over to the other gallery. He was just an incredibly talented, and Gordon Berg is his designer. You know, just very, very talented guy. And partnering with the Duesenberg brothers would really put him over the top.
I like how they saw the world differently.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, this is an era when everything was, you know, 90 degree angles and everything was straight. I mean, even men were shaped that way. They were men of grit, you know.
Yeah.
And they thought of curves and sweeping lines and, you know, the French curve and things like that that was just so outside the box at the time.
And this is a pretty stunning Packard, but just like the Cadillac we looked at before, had a rumble seat and golf clubs. This was another country club, because you could only hold two people.
Yeah. By the way, Ken, just so you know, I would daily this.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
Daily
Hands
driver.
Down. Well, no question.
When you think of daily drivers, would you like to see the very first Buick Roadmaster?
Would I ever?
This is a 36 Buick ADC. It was the first Roadmaster.
This is number one?
Yep. First one they built. 120 horsepower. They built a little over 1,000 of these. And but just stunning in terms of the paint, how that red just pops on the rims and on the belt line there.
Unbelievable. Well, this was kind of a bridge between Packard, Lincoln, and Model T.
Yeah.
This is kind of a bridge.
Yeah.
Or in this case, it would have been the Model B or the 32 Ford or something, which was still built as an everyman's car, you know, the working man's car, if you will. And I like how Buick thought, well, let's not go for the super high end and let's not shoot for the pizza eaters. Let's go for something in between.
Well, and they're still here.
And still here.
Still here, making beautiful cars.
Unfortunately, their cars are not as beautiful as this.
No, no.
I mean, if they still made this, who wouldn't want one of these?
Yes, I know.
I'd be like, what does it take to get me into one of these today?
Well, easy. I want to show you two more all original
cars. I don't
know
how much more my heart can take, Ken.
Okay, let's hop back over here. This Lincoln is all original, unrestored. It's a 1929 Model L. And you can see where the chauffeur has worn through the running board mat there.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the pivot point.
They only built 155 of these in 1929. And this is all unrestored, all original. You know, one of the things that always shows up first is the tinting on the windows. You can definitely tell it's, you know, but the thing about these cars, they were generally chauffeur maintained and stored in climate controlled garages. So
pampered.
That's why they're able to still look as good as they do.
So I have an original unrestored 1929 Ford Model A, which I'm not saying that to try and impress you because I know it's zero impress.
Well, no, but I love Model A's. Like I said, I drive Model A's more than I drive these cars. So
being the same year as this car, And although I drive mine now and then, not very often, but to see how much stripe is left on this, and it's like, because mine, almost all the stripe's gone on it
yeah,
now.
Yeah.
And the paint's been worn through in places.
Being parked outside.
Yeah, it's
too.
Just
a lot of time in the sun and all that. And these cars didn't spend that much time in the
sun. These cars were pampered.
Yeah.
And the amount of patina on this is, you know, and you would say, no way, that's not. You know, that thing got painted 20 years ago or something like that.
Yeah.
It's like, no. This was pampered. This is what a pampered car looks like 90 some odd years later.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's gorgeous. I'm so glad that people preserve cars. Mm-hmm. And I know that original cars or unrestored kind of made a comeback in the last 10 years or so. But, you know, prior to that, nobody wanted an unrestored car. And so many cars.
It was Jack Passy.
Jack.
Jack
correct.
Passy, you know, with his 90 all original unrestored Lincolns that really, you know, got people thinking. Because, you know, for a while there, people were getting a car. I'm going to make it look better than it is new. And they spent, you know, $30,000 on the car. And then they spent $30,000 to get it looking like brand new. And it's still only worth $50,000
something,
you know. And then you've destroyed, you know, the other thing, I've read a couple theories on this, the advent of DNA technology for crime solving also made people realize that you're stripping away all the DNA that of all the people that have ridden in this, particularly celebrity-owned cars.
True.
And, you know, and people realize, well, why am I doing this? You know, if it's still in good condition, it's not perfect, but it's still in good condition, keep it. And so now, unrestored cars, all original unrestored cars, you know, survivors are worth far more than you would for a car that's been all restored.
As it should be.
Yeah, yes.
Well, in my humble opinion.
I'm definitely in that camp with you, Paul. Yeah, definitely.
But I love, there's something about, and I've said it so many times, and people are going to be tired of hearing me say it, that when you restore a car, it loses something. So there people say they're only original ones. And people that have driven my four-door, they go, wow, I can't believe how tight this car is, how you know great it drives, whatever.
Yeah.
No restored car drives as good as my four-door. That no matter what level of restoration, even if you use all original parts, whatever, something's missing. It's not just DNA. I think it's the expertise of the people who assemble these, who was doing nothing but assembling these.
Yeah.
5, 6, 7 days a week, whatever they worked them back then. But those people knew how to build that car. They knew it better than you and I do. I can study the front end of this car as much as I want. I'm never going to understand exactly. Well, if you put it in this way, it's not going to be as tight
as
this.
Right.
So that DNA is lost
when
you restore the car. The original factory employee who knew what they were doing on this particular part of this car, it's gone.
Now this one's going to be a little bit harder to believe that it is all original and unrestored. So 1933 Cadillac 370C, town car.
Oh wow!
All original, unrestored. You see a few little spots here, but I mean
a little wear.
Look at this overall. You know, and this is when they kept the Landau bar.
Yeah.
You know, even though you didn't need it wasn't functional, you know, one of the last lines of cars to do that, the Ford Thunderbirds.
They brought those back and then they tanked, unfortunately.
Yeah. And once again, open car in the front because it was mimicking a carriage pulled by a horse where the driver sat outside.
And if the driver complains, you just fire him and hire another one.
There you go. Or put the canvas top on.
People are our most expendable asset. That's but the detail, like this belt strip here.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody restores that, they're going to make that look like that. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be like a mirror perfect finish. It's not going to look like that.
Yeah. Yep.
See, because people forget, I mean, even a really exquisite car came out of the factory with flaws.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've talked about this all the time where we talk about even like the 60s and 70s cars, you know, they wrote on them with chalk. You know, you look under a 60-something Corvette, and there's all kinds of chalk marks all over the bottom of it. Yeah. It didn't come perfect.
Yeah.
So this is what the song Stairway to Heaven was about.
Yeah. I love that. No one's ever said that before. Stairway to Heaven.
Leave it to the autistic YouTuber. I know what this is.
Yeah, and this one is new. It just came in, and I believe it is all original and restored.
This is an original Lincoln, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
I thought so, because I saw the seats immediately.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Obviously from the 40s, I'm not sure.
So, what is it? I don't know. It's got to
yeah,
be.
Yeah, well, it's because 40s was the push button.
Yeah, it's got to be early.
Spring loaded doors. Yeah, it's pretty early 40s. It doesn't, it's not 42. I wonder if it's like a 40 or 41.
You know, I've been up close and personal with Clara Ford's car that's at the museum, the Sacramento, California Auto Museum in Sacramento. And that car started out life as a late 30s Lincoln. And occasionally Clara would like something like the fenders of the 40 or something, and they yeah. would put that on her car. So her car's kind of like the Johnny Cash car, built over the years with different parts or whatever. But it very closely resembles this, at least yeah. in the front end, because she had the front end updated because she liked
look
it.
Look at all that.
But the difference between this car and Clara Ford's car is this one is slung a little lower, a little more sleek, more aerodynamic looking. Clara Ford's yeah. car is actually quite tall. And I asked why. The historian said that's because she liked to wear hats.
Oh.
And so her car is about this much taller.
Wow.
But seeing it like that, I mean, her car looks very stodgy and very proper. And
yeah.
This looks very sleek and sporty.
Yeah.
And again, sexiness on wheels.
So this is one of my favorite cars here. This is an unrestored, all original 47 Cadillac 62. You got to look at this car from the back. And you can see the love that they polished it so much. They bred the paint off the fenders.
Yeah.
But come around here, watch your step.
Well, yeah, you know what? This is the look that they always use in like the old Dick Tracy cartoons.
Yeah.
But you know why they did that look? Because it's hard to make a car look like it's going fast.
But this looks
in a
like
cartoon.
It's, right.
This looks like it's going fast, sitting here.
Oh, yeah. With the two-tone paint and just the way, yeah, I love this car.
This is incredible.
Well, I've never not owned a Cadillac, so I'm a big Cadillac fan.
I won't hold that against you.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
okay.
All original, unrestored. 1926 D74, and you know, we have a Marmon 16 that the museum owns. You're going to see in the next gallery too. It's
okay.
Pretty spectacular.
Wow. This is so nice. I mean, I have to believe I'm looking at it. It's right here.
Yeah.
It's like, wow. I mean, I know Marmon isn't. I mean, it wasn't an everyman's car, I know that.
No. I mean, it was almost $4,000 in 1926.
Yeah, this was way out of the reach of most people. But this is what somebody in those days, if you were going to be, I'm going to impress my friends when I go about the town tonight, this is what you would be in.
You would, yeah, absolutely.
And this is just gorgeous. The top is incredible on this. Yeah. I like how they've got it sectioned. I mean, that's pretty neat for an early car. This is a 1926.
Well, I love the slope, forward slope, yeah. carried over the roof, and then the lights yeah. in the back.
Right.
It's just, yeah.
So, you know, there was a lot of people talking about how antique cars were more aerodynamic going backwards than forwards. They were clearly talking about this.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because this has a parachute on front.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's the thing, though. See, though, this clearly was made before stoplights, because if you were at a stoplight,
you couldn't see
you'd
it.
Have to open the door, stick your head out the window, something.
This is another one of my favorite Packards here. This is a 41-180. And
a 1941.
Yeah.
Wow.
It is just a beautiful car. It only built 157 of these.
Oh, wow.
So probably only a handful of them even remain today.
I like the little clock for the passengers in the back seat.
This was the top of the line Packard in 1941.
James, you're going a little fast. We could slow down just a tad.
$3,000.
Yeah. This is what I would picture like Thurston Howell riding in.
I mean, this is another just spectacular car.
This is one of those colors they give a fancy name to, like Brandywine or something like that.
Something, yeah. Although, you know, some of that's more modern. Some of the cars, when you go back, they're just like blue, purple,
yeah,
yellow.
Or copra drab.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. But yeah, another beautiful.
So they were already using metallics in the paint.
Yeah, look at that. And it's just stunning.
I don't want to leave, but I know we have to. Yeah. There's more to see.
Yes.
Well, if going that way is Stairway to Heaven, I don't want to say what this way is. So as I head down the stairs to check out another part of the museum, can we talk about next year in Ruidoso, New Mexico? The Model A Ford Club of America National Convention is happening in Ruidoso, New Mexico, June 2024. It's a gorgeous little town. We're going to be staying at the MCM Elegante Hotel. Right across from the hotel is the convention center where all the activities happen. Very mild temperatures at this elevation in New Mexico. You don't have to worry about overheating. It's going to be a lot of fun with everything pretty centrally located. The sign-up forms are available right now on the Model A Ford Club of America website. See you next year in Ruidoso, New Mexico. Now, back to the show. Oh, Ken, thank you so much.
You are so welcome.
This is the Classic Car Club of America Museum. However, it is on the campus of the Gilmore Auto Museum, Hickory Corners, Michigan. I'll put it down here in the description. You got to check this out. What's really incredible about this, you know, we talked about with John Begg, so many museums have ropes. You can't get any closer than that to the car. You can't see anything. The Gilmore is a very up-close, personal experience. Don't touch, but you can get right up next to the cars. You can see the detail. There's no place else like it on Earth. Gilmore Auto Museum, check it out. Ken, I can't wait to see you again next year, buddy.
All right.
We're definitely doing this
again
next year.
We'll have a whole bunch of new exhibits next year.
It's always something new. Yeah. Awesome. Thanks, buddy.
All right. You're welcome. Thanks, Paul.